Okay, y'all ready for a wild ride this morning? All again.
All right, wild ride. We're going to try to do the whole chapter 17 together. We're just doing it in a hurry. Part of the reason is Jesus is really reiterating all that he's been saying that whole night up until now. And so we're not going to take a lot of time to go back to him and pick it apart, but we will read it, and it's a beautiful prayer. I titled the message, The Lord's Prayer. And I know that when we think of the Lord's Prayer, we think of the one in Matthew and Luke. But what I want you to know about that, if you want to turn that with me right quick, you can to Matthew chapter 6. But I'm just going to say something about it for a moment. What we call the Lord's Prayer is actually a model prayer. When the disciples went and they noticed that Jesus was quite an effective prayer, and then once again to say, teach us to pray like you pray. Be able to kind of get the results that you get and so forth. And so he gives them the Lord's Prayer, which is a model prayer. Let me just say a quick example. It starts out, he says, pray them in this way. Our Father, who is in heaven, hallowed be your name. Now, you don't have to say that every time you pray, but what he's saying is, begin your prayers by acknowledging who God is. That's the most important part, is acknowledging that you're talking to the Lord himself. And then he goes on to say, your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. And we've been talking a lot about this lately, about the will of God, and knowing what the will of God is and praying in the will of God. And we do that by of course, the Holy Spirit helps us with the Word of God. By reading it, we begin to know what is the will of God, and we pray that back to him. And how many of us are getting two ways to get answered? Because we just pray back what God's already said. And so he tells us that. Then he says, give us this day our daily bread. And that's kind of where we start sometimes, isn't it? We start with our needs or our wants. God, I need this real bad. It's just starting the other order. But then it has to be in there. Those are important as well. And then he says, forgive us our debts as we forgive our debts. And so forgiveness. I mean, I don't know about y'all, but I spend every single day. I haven't had an exception before. And so every single day, we need to go to God. And lead us not into temptation. How many of you need help with that? With temptation. I mean, that's why we sin, isn't it? Because of temptation. And we need help with that. And he says, to put that in your prayer. And then to deliver us from evil. And that's simply about praying the hands around us. To admit to God that we're not strong enough to do this thing. We need your help. We need a hedge around us because of the evil world. And that's what chapter 16 has been all about. Jesus is telling the disciples, and I'm about to leave you in a world that's not going to be a friendly world to you. And we will see that in his prayer today. And so, well, I stick all that to simply say this. John 17, this is the Lord's Prayer. This is truly the Lord's actual prayer. We get to see Jesus praying and what that looks like. Now, it's going to be broken into three parts. In the first five verses, Jesus is going to pray for himself. In the next 6 to 19 verses, about four times as many verses, he prays for his disciples. How many know that simply means we need four times as much prayer as Jesus does? So he's going to kind of do an extended part on that. And then he's going to get into verse 20 to 26, and we're going to camp on that a little bit when we get there. Because that is about him praying for the whole New Testament church. That would be us as well. I mean, you know that right here in recorded in the Bible is Jesus Christ praying for you. But that's what we have in these last seven verses of this chapter. This has been called the high priestly prayer because it's Jesus praying to the Father as a mediator on behalf of his followers. So after four chapters now, 13 through 16, of talking to the disciples, Jesus is now going to turn toward heaven, and he's going to talk to the Father, but on behalf of the disciples. This will be the longest recorded prayer in the New Testament. It's the second longest prayer in the whole Bible, and it's certainly the longest recorded prayer that Jesus used. It will be the last prayer, other than a few one-line prayers that might hear him say from the cross. This will be the last prayer that they will hear. hear him pray. And he'll pray one more time, a series of prayers in the Garden of Gethsemane, just a few moments after this prayer. But of course, if you know that story, the disciples missed those 3 days because they were asleep. So this will be the last prayer, and they actually get to hear this prayer. And it's such a special prayer. And I broke it up into 3 parts. Let me just say this real quick. If you'll look in your bulletin, you'll see an outline. And the first one is the glorification of blank father / blank son. And then the second part, we've got D-I-S-T-S. And the third part, we've got B-E-T-L-S. Let me tell you what happened there. This is the way I chose my sermon notes, with these little short things. And I copied and pasted and moved it over there, and then forgot to extend it out for Teresa. So when you read things with slashes and dashes and all that, I know what that means. You probably don't. But that's what it means right now. It means the glorification of the Father and the Son. That's what these first 5 verses are all about. I apologize for that. Let's just read the first 5 verses. Jesus spoke these things, and lifting up his eyes to heaven, he said, "Father, the hour has come. Glorify your Son, that the Son may glorify you, even as you have given him. Even as you gave him authority over all flesh, that to all whom you have given him, he may give eternal life. This is eternal life, that they may know you, the only true God, and Jesus Christ, whom you have sent. I glorified you on the earth, having accomplished the work that you gave and you've given me to do. Now, Father, glorify me together with yourself, with the glory which I had with you before the world was." Okay, so here's what I've just several little points I want to make on these 5 verses as we move too quickly. The Father in this section, these 5 chapters we've been looking at, this upper room discourse, the Father is mentioned 53 times. We know Jesus. What's beautiful about that is he is also the high Father. Jesus has made that plain to us. So he's passionate about the Father. 122 times the Father is mentioned in the book of John. That's what's special for us because that is the relationship we have with God. He is, as we say, sometimes he's our Father, sometimes he's our friend, all the time he is. But that he is our Father. The glory that he's speaking of in these 5 verses is the glory of the cross. The world looks at the cross as a revolting display of man's sin, but from a divine point of view, the cross magnifies the grace of God and the glory of God. And so Jesus is moving in these 5 verses from his pre-incarnate glory, that glory he had in heaven in eternity past, before he came down to earth as the God-man. And so he starts there, he moves to the glory that he achieved on the cross. And again, he hasn't been to the cross yet, but he's about to go, and it's as sure as it's already been done. He's talking about that glory on the cross and that finished ministry which brings glory to his Father. And now he's talking about also moving again to that glory back in heaven that he has with his Father again for all eternity, that special place of glory that he has. Now, there's a theme here that might surprise you a little bit. It's in verse 2, and that is that we are the Father's gift to the Son. You ever thought about yourself in that way when it comes to you and God, that you are a gift to Jesus? We tend to think of Jesus being the Father's gift to us. He sure is. But we too are a gift to the Son from the Father. And so, God gave the Son authority to save those that God gave to the Son. That's what we read in these verses. That'd be us. From our perspective, we receive the gift of eternal life when we believe in Jesus Christ. And that's true. But from heaven's perspective, we were actually given through the Son, by the Father, to keep them. And so that's also true. The Bible calls this divine election. And we make it real simple. We call it this. We say salvation by grace through faith. And that puts it all in a nutshell for us. But as Jesus finishes his work of redemption, now he's ready to be glorified in the heaven again. That's what he's saying in those five verses. Let's move on to the next part. This part is verses 6 through 19. This is going to be all about the preservation of his disciples. In other words, it's going to involve their security. It's going to involve their sanctity. Two very important things in the preservation of the disciples. So let's just read those verses, starting through verse 6. And I have manifested your name to the men whom you gave me out of the world. And they were yours, and you gave them to me, and they have kept your word. Now they have come to know that everything you have given me is from you. For the words which you gave me, I have given to them. And they received them and truly understood that I came forth from you, and they believed that you sent me. Now remember, this was a laborious process. Jesus had spent his whole time with his disciples trying to get them to this place, and now he's telling his Father, we've arrived. We're at that place. They're understanding. They're receiving all of this knowledge now. Verse 9. I ask on their behalf. I do not ask on behalf of the world, but of those whom you have given me, for they are yours. So a lot of talk about giving in these verses. And all things that are mine are yours, and yours are mine, and I have been glorified in them. I am no longer in the world, and yet they themselves are in the world, and I come to you. Holy Father, keep them in your name, the name which you have given me, that they may be one, even as we are one. I want you to really grab hold of this. This is all about unity, the unity of the body of Christ, and not just earthly. Like we would think that. He's talking about having the same kind of unity that the Father and the Son have. We'll look at that a little bit closer in just a moment. Verse 12, while I was with them, I was keeping them in your name, which you have given me. And I guarded them. And not one of them perished, but the Son produced so that the Scripture would be fulfilled. We know that was Jesus' story. But now I come to you, and these things I speak to the world so that they may have my joy made full in themselves. We talked about that last week in chapter 16, about what that means. I have given them your word, and the world has hated them, because they are not of the world, even as I am not of the world. And then we talked about that in verse chapter 16. I do not ask you to take them out of the world, but to from the evil one. They are not of the world, even as I am not of the world. Sanctify them in the truth. Your word is truth. And as you sent me into the world, I also sent them into the world for their sake. I sanctify myself, that they themselves also may be sanctified in truth. All right, let's go back and still pick a few verses out of this that maybe we haven't elaborated on already in the past few chapters, and just kind of tell you what's going on in verse 6, where we started this section. He says, I have manifested your message. What that means is that Jesus came to reveal the eternal nature of God. The name itself, the name of Jesus, is the name that actually means Savior. And so Jesus came manifesting or showing us the saving nature of God. And that's what he came to do. Now, in verse 11, I want you to notice that prayer at the end of verse 11. In the middle of the verse, he says, Holy Father, keep them in your name, the name which you have given me, that they may be one, even as we are. Here's what's so important for us to know about. This is a beautiful prayer. This is keep. Here's what we know about Jesus. He always does pray to us. Aren't you glad? Because this is the prayer he's prayed for us. He always got his prayers answered. Look on the front of your bulletin. And our verse today, just look at the middle part there, the red part. Jesus, back when he raised Lazarus from the dead, if you remember that, he prayed this prayer. He says, Father, I thank you that you have heard me. I knew that you always hear me. And so he always hears the Son. So when Jesus prays for us, you can bet those prayers are going to be answered because the Father will hear those prayers. And he has a beautiful thing. And so that's good for us to know. Now look at verse 12. We see in verse 12 that Jesus, therefore, is interceding for these disciples. And when he's doing so, he's guaranteeing their security in the world. Verse 15. Read verse 15 again. He says, I do not ask you to take them out of the world, but to keep them from the evil one. There's a passage in Luke where this is already about to be experienced. Same story, but over in Luke's version, when we're moving toward the cross, Jesus told Simon Peter this. He said, Simon, Simon, behold, Satan has demanded of perfection to speak to you last week. Yet, yeah, that means Satan has to ask permission before he can do this. But I have prayed for you. We just sing when Jesus prayed, God bless you, God the Father bless you, that your faith may not fail. We know the ending of that. Faith didn't fail. And you, once you have turned again, strengthen your brothers. In other words, not only are you not going to fail, but I'm going to use you for some powerful things in your future. And so, Satan wanted a different outcome. But Jesus said, no, you can't touch him in that way. In verse 17 is that beautiful verse where he says, sanctify them in your truth. And sanctify there, the word means to set apart for God's good pleasure, so that His will, as we are sanctified, His will become our will. And that comes from knowing the truth and living out the truth. And that we're sanctified in it and we're becoming more and more like Him all the time. Now, we get into that third section. This is where I want to spend the rest of our time. And we have a big meeting coming up, and so we're going to close it a little bit earlier today. So we're going to spend a little time on this, and then we'll close that up. But this is about the unity of all of His believers. And again, this is going to include us. And here's what we read in verse 25. I do not ask on behalf of Jesus alone, who's been praying for His immediate disciples at this point, but for those who also believe in me through their word. Now, let's just read the rest of it. That they may all be one, even as you, Father, are in me and I in you, that they also may be in us, so that the world may believe that you sent me. The glory which you have given me, I have given to them, that they may be one just as we are one. And in them, and you in me, I am in you, that they may be perfected in you. So that the world may know that you sent me and love me, even as you have loved me. And y'all can imagine this. Father, I desire that they also, that you have given me, be with me where I am, so that they may see my glory, which you have given me, for you loved me before the foundation of the world. O righteous Father, although the world has not known you, yet I have known you, and these have known that you sent me, and I have made your name known to them, and will make it known, so that the love with which you love me, may be in me, and I in me. All right, that's some pretty good stuff. Let's break it up just a little bit. Verse 20, it says, again, I don't ask them on behalf of these alone, but for those who will believe in me through their word. In other words, these disciples' words. What he's saying here is that means the New Testament. because it's going to be their words that we read throughout the rest of the New Testament and the Gospel. They will write about all this, and we will learn and read about what they're saying in their words about Jesus. So Jesus, he's got several desires right here in these last verses. One desire is that for us to be united by his word. In other words, that will be what we're united under. I think of it sometimes like a constitution. Right? We talk about our constitution, and we're careless with our American constitution sometimes, but we're not supposed to do it. We're supposed to live by its framework. And I think about the word of God in that way to simply say this: if we as Christians, all of us, everybody in the body of Christ, if we would all abide by the word of God, there would never be any fear of partiality, there would never be any fear of favoritism, because everyone would be on the exact same page about all things all the time. Okay? That's especially when it comes to unity. And that's what he's asking, because you know, you've been around churches all your life, you've heard private churches, maybe. There's a lot of discord that goes on in churches. There's a lot of dissension and division and different things and lost strife and things. And it's not just churches now. Paul wrote all about it in Corinthians and in Galatians and in Ephesians and different places. There's a lot of that going on. We know that that is very much the devil's plan. It's very much easy to do because we're all still in the flesh, but we are to be living by the Spirit and by the Word of God. And so when we all were living by the Word of God, then we're all on the exact same page about all things always. So there should be no discord, no division, no dissension. Matter of fact, Proverbs 6:16 tells us this. There are six things which the Lord hates. I think it's interesting when you see a list of things God hates. You're like, I'm not on the floor. But here it is. He says, yes, even seven. So he ups the one. Seven which are an abomination to him. Look what he says. The first one is haughty eyes. It has to do with pride. And a lying tongue. Hands that shed innocent blood. A heart that devises wicked plans. Feet that run rapidly to evil. A false witness who utters lies. I couldn't help but say, this sounds just like the actual, I went on it, look, the party platform for one of our political parties this year. This looks like it right here. Practically all these things are included in there. And then he finishes with this one. And one who spreads strife among the brothers. This is an abomination. For the brothers to spread strife among one another. And we'll see in a moment, because this is our testimony to the world about who God is and what he's doing in us. And God takes it very seriously. There was a Puritan preacher named Thomas Brooks, and he said this: discord and division become no Christian. For wolves to worry the lambs is no wonder, but for one lamb to worry another, this is unnatural and monstrous. After all, the Word of God is truth, right? It's what Jesus told us in verse 17. Now, I try not to talk about politics in pulpit, but we've got such an important election coming up in just a few days that I feel like I need to say just a few things. And this is what I want to say about that. Because I want to say something about the election in the church. If the church looks at this thing, it should not be so much about the politicians, the rest of the world looking at it like this. The church needs to be looking at it not so much about the politicians as they are about the politicians. What kind of things are these politicians going to implement? These are the things that hurt people or help people or line up with biblical values or run against biblical values, whatever the case may be. And so it's the policies that the church needs to be focused on. It's not always easy to discern the character of the politician. That's not the case with the policies. We can actually define the policies. We can know about the policies. And in my view, as a pastor, the job of the church, the role of the church, is to pick that lane where the policies most closely line up with the Word of God. That's what we're looking for as the church. It's for our leaders to have policies that will line closely with the Word of God. This year is pretty easy. It's a pretty easy decision. Except for one thing. Statistics tell us, I heard this last week from the leader, that when you consider everybody that considers themselves Christians, all the different denominations and so forth, that there are over 140 million Christians who are not even registered today. Over 40 million of those are evangelical Christians. People who claim that the Word of God is their all in all. It's everything that we base on, everything we believe upon. Yet, much more people that would be needed to not even make this a podcast would be there if they would leave the pew, go register, and then they vote their values based on the Bible. So we're in a lot of trouble with the church. And I know you've heard it said over and over again that this might be the most important election we've ever had. We say that every 4 years, don't we? But I think this one really fits the best of things. Certain things happen, and we could play with those discussions. It doesn't matter. And then Christianity could be something truly under great pressure. But the church can answer if we just will. So that's all I'm going to say about this. Please rest and please pray. Now, verse 21, first part of verse 21 says, that they may all be one, even as you, Father, are in me, I in you, so that they also may be in us. The kind of one that he's talking about here is a one that means they are so close that there is no light in between. I mean, they are just that close, no light in between them at all. Like the Trinity of God, the Father, the Son, the Holy Spirit. He's saying, I want them to be that close. Three distinct persons, yet one God. Now, I want to tell you something, that's tight. When he says I want them to be as tight as we are in the Trinity, that's tight. But that's what God desires of his church, that we be like that. But I want you to know something. We've been told for years, and it's still the case today, the most segregated hour of the week in America is the worship hour. The modern church has divided itself into black and white and Hispanic and Asian and Greek churches and even more. Not to mention Baptists and Methodists and Presbyterians and on and on and on. We have to divide it ourselves. And here's what we need to know. Everybody in the church needs to know this. There should only be one kind of church, no matter who we are or where we're from, and that should be the Bible church. I should have got 58 amens on that one. The Bible church. We should be the church that's lined up on the Word of God. That's what he's saying right here. I want them to unify under the Word. Once we do that, we're going to all be alike. We're going to be unified by the Word of God because what we know is that division is from Satan. And the opposite is God's plan. We read it right here in Ephesians 4, verses 1 to 6. Paul's telling in Ephesians, he says this, therefore, I, the prisoner of the Lord, implore you to walk in a manner worthy of the calling with which you have been called, with all humility and gentleness and patience, showing tolerance for one another, in love, being diligent to preserve the unity of the Spirit in the bond of peace, there is one body and one spirit, just as also you were called in one hope of your calling, one Lord, one faith, one baptism, one God and Father of all, who is over all and through all and in all. And I don't think I can say any more than that. Paul is saying, we're one. We're the big one. It's important for us to be diligent in making sure that we have that kind of oneness. Now look again at verse 21 and 10. So that the world may believe that you sent me. Here's what we need to know. Our level of oneness will be the same as our level of testimony. In other words, our level of oneness will represent the effectiveness of our testimony. That's what the world will see. Verse 22 again, the glory which you've given me, I've given to them, that they all may be one, just as we are one. Jesus' desire is for us to be unified through the glory that he's given us. Look what John said. 1 John 3:2, beloved, now we are all children of God, and has not appeared as yet what we will be, but we know that when he appears, we'll be like him, because we will see him just as he is. To take it even deeper, in verse 23, he says, I am them and you and me, that they may be perfected in unity. How many of you know that's a huge calling? Perfected in unity. But Jesus' desire is that we will be united with him in the experience of his Father's love. That's what it says there in that verse, and then in verse 24. Father, I desire they also, and you have given me, be with me where I am, so they may see my glory. Jesus' desire is that one day we're going to be with him where he is now and see his glory. This is what we read in Ephesians 2:4-7. If God, being rich in mercy, raised us up with him, seated us with him in the heavenly places in Christ Jesus, so that in the ages to come he might show the surpassing riches of his grace and kindness toward us in Christ Jesus. He's going to sit us right there with Jesus. And all Jesus is glory, he's going to be right there with me. I want him to see and experience my glory. So what's that going to look like? Well, go back to the front of your bulletin. We're used to seeing pictures of Jesus. You know, we've kind of made up some stuff throughout the years. He's a Caucasian-looking male with long, black, brown hair. That's the way we see Jesus so many times in the pictures. That's the picture we have to have here. I didn't pick this picture. It just happens to be the one, because this is the most common one that we see. In other words, just the average appearance. You know what? That's backed up by what Isaiah said about him before he ever came. This is what he said in Isaiah 53. For he grew up before them like a tender shoot, like a root out of parched ground. He has no stately form or majesty that we should look upon him, nor appearance that we should be attracted to him. Isaiah says he's just going to be a very average looking guy. As far as his looks, there's going to be nothing special about that. But I want you to know something, church. That is not going to be kept when he is glorified once again in heaven where he is right now. We have the scriptures in the Word of God what that's going to look like. Let's read a couple of them. Revelation 1. In the middle of the lampstand, John said, I saw one like the Son of Man. He was clothed in a robe reaching to the feet and girded across his chest with a gold staff. His head was terrible, white, white, wool. Black snow, and his eyes were like a flame of fire, and his feet were like burnished bronze when he was being made to glow in the furnace. And his voice was like the sound of many waters. In his right hand, he held seven stars, and out of his mouth came a sharp two-edged sword, and his face was like the sun shining in strength. Then we get another one at the end of Revelation. And I saw heaven open, and behold, a white horse, and he who sat on it saw faithful and true and righteousness. He judges and wages war, and his eyes are a flame of fire, and on his is me diabetes. He has a name written on him, which no one said no except himself. He's clothed in the robe dipped in blood, and his name is called the Word of God. And so we get just a few pictures of what it, there's several more, of what it's going to look like to see him in his glory. It's going to be hard for us to take it in. It's going to be so beautiful. And Jesus is saying, I want mine to be there with me. I want my people to see that glory, to experience that glory. And then in verse 25 and 26, we read those verses. We simply say this, the basis for true Christian unity is the person and the work of the Lord Jesus Christ. As we close here today, here's what we have to know. That will be our witness in the world. Our unifying around the person and the work of the Lord Jesus Christ. You see, the world cannot see God with their eyes. They cannot see God, but they can see Christians. And what they see in us is what they will believe about God. If they see love, community, they will believe that God is the God of love. But if they see hatred and discord and dissension, they will reject the gospel. Would that no one will ever look at Jesus and then look at us and say, I would have become a Christian. Would have not been Christian. And God in his authority can say that one time and say, probably not Jesus or whatever. But he looked and said, I would have become a Christian myself, would have not been, but I saw him as Christian. Let our testimony be that of completely in the Word of God. And the glory of Jesus himself, and then the love of the Father. These are three things that we point out here in this prayer that we want us to be given by God. His Word, His glory, and His love. Amen? Amen. We're going to sing this morning. And then, we have an invitation. I invite you to come. If you have not ever received Christ, beautiful time to do it. If you'd like to join the church this morning, you talk to me about that. If you want to come this morning, this will be a good time to do that as well. Hopefully, you can come. Okay. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, Lord, you are great. You are great in your presence. You're such a good Father. You're a good Savior. If you're always good, Lord, you're just so thankful. Pray, Lord, that what you're going to do will bring you back to the church. That we will always live in the church as being your church. That we will never look at it as a church. Always be the one that makes you the one to do it. And always see the God in the church. To know your will. To follow through on what you say. Not to be just a one time and over. But all through this process, that we constantly stay close, such that we can find the bridge to what God wants to do to us. Lord, we just pray that you will be on the side of your church to make this to us to that church. And thank you for your love, for the way that everyone is. Come to your place, and express to us today. Go with us now, Lord, and bring us back in just a few hours. This is kind of a great time of fellowship together. And to continue to prove with the unity of the body. Lord, we want to have fellowship. I pray, Lord, that we can find the way to rise and come. That all of us can be the Lord's body. That we can be the Lord's body. That we can be the Lord's body. That we can be the Lord's body. Thank you. Thank you, everyone.